Hello dear students, how are you? I hope you all are sitting at home and studying the subjects properly. And even though the situation is under control, I think it takes a lot of time for us to become normal. And under these circumstances, online class appears to be unavoidable for us. Hence, I am trying to present the videos in a more comfortable way, so that you all can sit at home and study the subject properly. And today we are going to discuss about presumption. Amnia presumptor reitesse acta. This is the Latin maxim, which means all acts are presumed to be rightly done. Generally, presumption means a process of ascertaining of facts on the basis of possibility. This principle is the base for Section 4 of Indian Evidence Act. Section 4 of the Act says that wherever and whenever it is provided by this Act that the court may presume a fact, it may either regard such fact as proved unless and until it is disproved, or may call for proof of it. And whenever and wherever it is directed by this Act that the court shall presume a fact, it shall regard such fact as proved unless and until it is disproved. Here, if you observe, may presume is giving a chance or an opportunity, a discretionary power to court to define a particular fact in its own way, depending on the circumstances. Whereas, shall presume directing the court to follow a certain procedure, because it is a presumption of law. It is an artificial presumption, or it is an obligatory presumption. It directs the court to do a certain act in a certain way. Here I will give an example which differentiate may presume and shall presume clearly. For example, in may presume, if a person is missing for the last 7 years, then court may presume that the person who is missing is dead, but court can ask for submission of evidence also if they are not satisfied with the statement given by the person who is submitting that particular fact before the court. Whereas if a person below 7 years, that is a child, if committed an offense, then court shall presume that a person below 7 years cannot commit any offense. And then what is conclusive proof? It is said to be conclusively proved when one fact is declared by this Act to be the conclusive proof of another. And so conclusive proof is a condition when one fact is established. For example, see this paper. Here you can observe the stamp of the court. This shows that as far as the matter regarding this particular issue is concerned, this is the final and conclusive proof. And if you want to rebut it, you can say that this particular stamping itself is fraud, and it is not by the court but by the person who submitted it. Then if you can prove it, then court may come to another conclusion. Otherwise, if it is presumed that this stamping is genuine, then this judgment regarding to this particular fact is final. Sections 42, 112 and 113, 41 of the Evidence Act and Section 82 of Indian Penal Code deals with this conclusive proof. First time in the year 1905, Privy Council explained about may presume and shall presume in the case of Emperor versus Srinivas, and the same is reiterated by Indian courts also. And our Supreme Court, in the case of Amar Chand Dutt versus Second Additional DJ in the year 1988, and also in the case of Geetika Bagheji versus Subhabro Bagheji in the year 1996, and also in the case of Imran Khan versus State of Maharashtra in the year 2019, time and again explained or defined what is meant by presumption, may presume and shall presume, under what circumstances court is going to presume a particular fact. Therefore, by going through all these definitions and other explanation given in the Act, we can come to a conclusion that presumption of facts, which are known as material presumptions or natural presumptions, are those which are inferences, are natural and are reasonable conclusions of existence or non-existence of a fact. And presumptions relating to law are, even though rebuttable, basing on the circumstances, they are artificial and they are obligatory. Now, we will see certain presumptions that are sections 79 to 90 of the Indian Evidence Act deals with the presumption of genuinity of a document. Section 79 to 85 and section 89 of the Act deals with the presumption, that is the genuinity of a document, as shall presume. It gives a direction to court to presume a document in a particular direction, whereas sections 86 to 88 and section 90 of the Act deals with mere presume. Now, section 79 of the Act deals with the certified copies, whereas section 80 of the Act deals with the record of court, which may be used in the present court from a previous case. And section 81 of the Act deals with gazettes and also newspapers, etc. And section 82 particularly deals with the recognized documents of governments, England government as well as Indian government. And section 83 deals with the maps and plans made by the government. And section 84 deals with the collection of laws and reports. Section 85 AIRs like that. Section 85 deals with GPA. And section 88 deals with execution of a document not produced before the court. And now let us see what is meant by these recognitions. In all these cases, if you observe, almost all the documents are recognized or made by either government or by the judiciary. This is the first point you are supposed to note. Here, court shall presume that these documents are genuine until and unless they are disproved by the opposition party. And in all these documents, the genuinity will be taken into consideration basing on the signatures, stamping, and all other required pro forma are correctly and genuinely made. Sections 86 to 88, if you observe, these are made by somebody other than the government. First one, section 86, deals with the foreign judgments or judicial records of foreign countries. And section 87 relating to the books, maps, or charts, which the person who is submitting certain facts before the court wants to use as a supportive evidence for his case to prove the fact. And section 88 relating to the telegraphic message. And section 90 deals with 30 years old documents, and it will be presumed as genuine if at all those documents are in the proper custody. Here you may get a doubt that what is proper custody. Proper custody means when A wants to sell his property to B and he entered into a sale agreement wherein he mentioned that before getting certain necessary permissions from government, I am handing over all my originals to the person who is buying the land from me. Like this, if there is a sentence in the sale agreement, then it can be presumed that the documents are with the buyer. If that sentence is not there in the agreement, then we can presume that the documents are with the seller. Like that only, when there is a joint family, it will be presumed that all the necessary documents relating to the joint family property will be in the custody of the karta of the family. Presumption of natural facts, human conduct and business. These things are explained under sections 113A, 113B and section 114. Sections 113A and 113B deals with the committing of suicide or death of a married woman, whereas section 114 deals with the natural facts and also human conduct and also about public and private businesses. Here I want to give you an illustration so that you can easily follow the subject. If a marriage fulfills all the conditions which are required as per Hindu Marriage Act under sections, as you are not there in front of me, I am supposed to tell the sections also. Sections 5 and 7 of the Act says about the valid marriage conditions. If at all those conditions are fulfilled, then any child born out of that wedlock is going to be treated as legitimate child. Relating to the presumption of natural facts, I want to discuss along with an illustration so that he can easily understand the concept. A and B married on June 1st and the husband left the home next day, and after 6 months he came to know that his wife is pregnant, and now immediately he filed a divorce petition in the court, and where he requested the Honorable Court to declare that the child is illegitimate, and also they requested that he need not pay any maintenance damages to his wife. In this case, basing on the presumption of conclusive proof, court rejected his plea and stated that he was with his wife for at least one day, and therefore court shall not allow him to submit any further proof contrary to the conclusive proof, even if he provides probative evidence. In Chagan Singh versus State of Madhya Pradesh, where the court acquitted the accused basing on the presumption that there is a long gap between the committing of suicide by the wife and harassment she faced in the hands of her husband. In this case, actually husband is having illicit relation with another woman, and he is regularly harassing his wife and not even providing food or other necessities to wife and children. Hence his wife stolen some rice from the house. When she is stealing the rice bags, he caught her and he immediately beaten up her severely. After 4 or 5 months, she committed suicide. Therefore, court felt that there is no connectivity between committing of suicide and that particular act. Still, they felt it amounts to harassment, as he is convicted under Section 498A and acquitted under Section 306. If you observe one fact, for these sections where court is presuming about the committing of suicide or death of a married woman, they are depending on Dowry Prohibition Act for the definition of dowry and 498 of IPC for the definition of cruelty. And there are so many other cases where court gave presumptions and decided the cases. For a few cases I want to mention here: Neelakanth Pathi cases and Mangal Ram cases and Shantaram cases. The Shantaram case you might have studied in your Hindu Marriage Act. In business, whenever there is any negotiable instrument drawn, then it will be presumed that it is drawn for the purpose of a good consideration. Like that only when a particular property is continuously passing on in the same family from generation to generation, the general presumption will be it is an ancestral property, unless it is proved otherwise. Like that only when a person refuses to answer to a question which is not compelled by the law to answer, the court may presume that even if he answers the question, the answer might be unfavorable to him. Here, if you remember, now most of the conditions you can observe, or you, if you are having in your own experiences, you can even recollect them. Whenever we receive any notice from court, we try to avoid it, we reject it. Means we are rejecting to answer to the judiciary. 100% there is a possibility for judiciary to take it in a negative way, and the court may pass an order against the person who rejected to receive the notice. Now, if you understood the concept of presumption, basically wherever the presumption is basing on law, there law directs. In all other places, the presumption of the court is basing on the principle that the person who is submitting something in the court is innocent until and unless his guilt is proved. This is the basic principle for even IPC also. And with this, now I am concluding today's lecture, and we will meet in the next class.